This is Ham Radio Now, episode 179, A Christmas Truce. No, not peace breaking out on 14313. Nothing like that. This is a special event that's got something to do with World War I. Not a lot of ham radio back in World War I, so we'll find out what it's all about. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. As usual, Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. So stop by hamradionow.tv. Look for Arvin's icon, our chief financial officer. If you've enjoyed the programs, you get something out of them, then maybe you can help us out. We're looking for 10 bucks a year from 10,000 hams. We're a long way from the 10,000 hams, but we've done better than 10 bucks a year from most of the folks that have made contributions. So thank you very much. If you've already contributed sometime, really appreciate that. You know, this is coming up on the Christmas holiday, and you may have more important things to do with your money. Buying presents for the kids, the spouse, the parents, maybe even the office Christmas party. So put us at the very end of the list. If there's anything left over, then you can help out Ham Radio Now. And if not, you know, we'll see you next year. So sorry, Arvin, I've just taken your business away from you this year. All right, so a Christmas truce. This is a special event operation that took place in the middle of the country, and I've got a couple of guys from Kansas City. Kansas City, right?
Yep.
Which one?
Missouri.
KCMO.
Yep.
The big Kansas City, Missouri. Introduce yourselves, guys. Who are you?
Well, I've scripted this.
I'm Herb. What I can tell, so far is you're both very polite.
Yeah.
Okay, the guy in the blue, go first.
Okay, I'm Herb. I'm NZ0F. And I'm Randy, KD0HKD.
All right. And the reason that I'm talking to you is, what is the reason I'm talking to you?
Well, we're talking about the centennial of the World War I special events that we're doing. And this one specifically is the Christmas Truce.
All right. So this is a ham radio operation. It would pretty much have to be in order to be on this show.
Sure.
So what are you guys doing?
We are doing a special event for a 31-hour period on the weekend of December 27th and 28th as a commemoration of the Christmas Truce in World War I from 1914. The event is being done in conjunction with the National World War I Museum here in Kansas City, and it's the fourth event in a relationship that we started with the museum earlier this year.
Christmas Truce. Tell me what that is so I can start to understand what it is that you're doing the ham radio part for.
It was an unofficial truce leading up to Christmas in 1914 where British and to a lesser extent French troops basically started exchanging songs and communication with their opposite numbers in the German trenches until finally they came out and talked to each other. Exchange gifts, one of the big remembrances was that they actually played a game of football or soccer between the two sides
in the battlefield.
In the battlefield, in no man's land.
So if when we think of World War I, we think that things are pretty vicious. World War II was also very vicious. People didn't get along. People didn't make nice. So this sounds pretty unusual.
It's very unusual when you consider that the commanders don't want you to think of the opposite side as being people. They're supposed to be considered monsters that you want to destroy. In this case, they were singing the same Christmas carols in different languages and found a common thread there.
So the holiday is it's a common holiday.
Yes.
It was a holiday in Germany, was a holiday in France, was a holiday in England, holiday here.
Right.
So everybody got along in terms of that.
Right.
And they knew when it was. It was.
And it was an unofficial truce. It wasn't anything that was organized at command level.
All right. So this was Christmas Eve that was the truce. Your special event operation is not Christmas Eve. It's a couple days later on the weekend.
Right. We didn't want to get people out of their homes to
that would be tough, yeah.
To play ham radio on Christmas Eve.
There wouldn't be anybody on the air to talk to.
Right.
Well, there'd probably be no one home to talk to when we got back.
Yeah.
Too,
so. Yeah. It will have to be a short, pretty short event. Let's find out a little bit about this place that you are doing the special event. And then we'll talk about the ham radio stuff in greater depth. Why do you select World War One? What's the deal about World War One? I guess that's going to lead us into your venue.
Okay. Herb? Well, I don't think we selected World War One. I think World War One selected us. It all started about 2 years ago with a gentleman named Clay Wilson, N0WWI, who has been a longtime volunteer with the museum. And with the upcoming centennial observance of World War One, which started in June of 1914, the museum staff and volunteers got together and said, what can we do during this 1914 centennial celebration, or not celebration, commemorance, that would be special, that would be something unusual, that would be something that would draw people to the museum and provide some public outreach to people who might not have thought much about World War One previous to this. And Clay, being a ham, said, well, why don't we do a ham radio special event station? And of course, hardly anybody on the staff there knew what that meant. But as it turns out, the chairman of the museum's father is a ham in Australia. He's a VK. And so that immediately resonated with him. It started to build some momentum, and a group of us got together about a year and a half ago to start planning. And the Christmas Truce event is event number 4 for this year, and we intend to continue this on for another 3.5 years, doing about 3 or 4 events a year.
All right. Well, I want to know more about the museum, because we haven't really explained what that's all about yet, but that's your connection. There's a museum there that is your connection for this, and that's why it's World War One. I hadn't even thought very much, and I don't know if I've encountered much on the media, general media, that 2014 is 100 years after essentially the beginning of World War One. I know the war had a kind of a vague beginning. And my history teachers in high school are going to be pretty mad at me for not remembering the details here. But it is about 100 years since that war became a big deal and wasn't just a skirmish someplace.
Right. The National World War One Museum at Liberty Memorial is the official name. Liberty Memorial was built in Kansas City within 10 years after the end of World War One. It started with local businesses coming up with the idea and children donating nickels and dimes from the Kansas City area. And they built this beautiful, beautiful memorial about 10, 15 years ago. Came to the conclusion that the memorial was in desperate need of repairs. And once again, the people of Kansas City pitched in, collected nickels and dimes, and did a beautiful job of rebuilding the memorial. And at the same time, the museum is literally underneath the memorial. It's a world-class museum, and it has been designated as the National World War One Museum in the United States. It's a world-class museum. It provides great educational opportunities. That's the view from the memorial across at Union Station and towards downtown Kansas City. What more could I add?
No, that's it. And it is the extent of the museum itself was redone in the early 90s, and it is a world-class museum, totally dedicated to World War One, and it is the National World War One Museum. There is nothing else like it in the country.
Okay. I guess we're looking at the memorial part itself now.
Yes.
Right. And the bronze doors you see at the bottom is the entrance to the museum.
All right. So, when we were just getting this program started, I was kidding you guys, saying, "You're what part of Washington D.C. are you in?" Because that's where you think of as all the memorials. So, and the guys at the museum are going to be mad now because poking fun. But it's in Kansas City.
Right.
What's it about Kansas City that landed this museum?
The interesting story of that is there's nothing special about Kansas City with regard to World War One. It is just that Kansas City was the first city in the nation to decide that a memorial was needed for World War One, and they raised the money to build that in the span of about 2 weeks.
It was a year.
In a very short period of time. So it was just kind of Kansas City was first to the draw on building a memorial, and so therefore it became the national memorial for World War One.
And when they dedicated the museum, it was the first time since the war,
first and only time,
that all of the generals, all the leaders of those Allied powers, came together in one place.
All right, I'm going to look look at the Google map one more time, and got the museum right there in the center, and I'm going to kind of zoom out, and we can see where it is in relationship to Kansas City. Probably when they did this, they were kind of in the suburbs or in the outskirts of the city.
Well, not quite. It was a park, and I think they selected the location because it was right across the street from Union Station, which at the time was a huge hub of people coming and going on railroad travel. Yeah.
And it actually had been built about 10 years previous.
Right.
All right.
So I think this view is actually, that you just showed, I think is actually from Union Station. It's the opposite direction. Okay, never mind.
Yeah, okay. We're hams, not historians.
Yeah, you have the same problem. Okay, so the ham radio connection began earlier this year when you started to come up with the idea of doing some special events.
Right.
And what was the first one?
The first one was sponsored by my organization, the Raytown Amateur Radio Club. Raytown's another suburb of Kansas City. I was president at the time, and it was commemorating the assassination of Archduke Ferdinand, which is considered by many to be the spark that ignited the war. That date fell on the same weekend as Field Day. So it was kind of a challenge that we were doing a combination special event in Field Day at the same time, because Raytown Amateur Radio Club has always been a very big participant in Field Day. So it was an interesting challenge, but we got it done. And not only did we do it with respect, and we had an awful lot of fun doing it. So we had the honor of being the first. After that... Go ahead. I'm sorry.
I was going to try to bring up the video that you guys have got. Vimeo is giving me a little trouble, but you guys. Oh, there we go.
We're at our Field Day.
Yeah. Site, that guy looks familiar.
Is at the National World War One Museum. It's our, at Liberty Memorial.
Safety yellow shirts that we.
We're doing this not only as a birthday, but in commemoration.
So this is the assassination of Archduke. This was your Field Day activity earlier this year.
Yes.
And this is typical of the previous three events where we've set up basically kind of a Field Day setup on the lawn of the memorial and set up temporary towers and temporary antennas and a temporary operating tent and operated, the full 31 hours around the clock from when the museum opens on Saturday to when the museum closes on Sunday.
So Archduke Ferdinand was assassinated on Field Day.
Yes, unfortunately for us.
Although there wasn't a Field Day, as we discovered in the last last episode of Ham Radio Now, Field Day started in 1933, so we weren't doing that yet. In fact, ARRL had not been officially inaugurated until 1915, so...
Coming up here, it will show a dignitary that was visiting the operation... United States ambassador to Bosnia, which is where the assassination took place in Sarajevo. The ambassador visited our operation, and just by pure coincidence or luck, the operator made contact with a station from Bosnia.
Wow.
At the exact same time.
God, I can imagine, CQ Bosnia for about an hour and never never getting anything. But
there he is.
Okay, that's your guy.
And that's Clay on the right there.
Yes.
With the red lanyard around his neck.
Okay.
And the operator with the headset on was actually communicating with Bosnia at that time. We didn't arrange for the flyover of the Memphis Belle, but boy, that was
kind of cool.
Yeah.
You guys are just having all kinds of luck.
Yeah.
We've had a blast.
All right. So that doesn't really want to play very well anymore.
You probably saw a number of our corporate sponsors on that video who supplied equipment to our various events. Icon America supplied the radios. Ararat Shrine supplied a tower. U.S. Towers supplied another portable tower. My organization, Raytown Amateur Radio Club, supplied a 15-kilowatt generator. Step IR supplied an antenna, and KC Webb, a local internet provider, provided wireless internet access.
And Associated Radio, our local candy store, provided us a lot of supplies and a lot of support.
Yep.
So how do you guys go about getting that much support for an operation like this?
You ask a lot of people. It's not easy. You know, it helps to have the right connections, and we were blessed with a couple of people on the committee that had connections with some of these organizations, and you just kind of work your network. But it's not an easy task. We discovered that.
I mean, this is a learning opportunity for viewers, for people who might want to do something like that. And you know, their attention suddenly got riveted when they discovered you didn't pay for all this all by yourselves. You got a lot of donations.
Oh, so yeah.
They want to know how. So.
Right. And
so you had to formulate some kind of a pitch.
Mm-hmm.
And then you make the pitch, and then nothing happens, because that's what happens when you make your first pitch.
We couldn't thank these guys enough. And so we definitely wanted to thank them for their support and get their name out there. And when N0 IRS JD produced that video, it was an opportunity there again for us to make sure that those sponsors were highlighted.
Yeah, let's give JD some credit too. N0 IRS is his call sign, and we have determined that we don't know how to pronounce his last name.
I'm sure it's JD Dupuy.
Okay, JD. But everybody just calls him JD.
D-U-P-U-Y.
And he's becoming famous by supplying a lot of videos to Ham Nation. So.
Yes.
He's very creative. He as a video editor, I have dedicated my life to making only cuts and maybe an occasional dissolve. And if you watch the Ham Radio Now videos, you see every once in a while I'll have I need to show my whole self here, a picture pushed from one side to the other. And that's my big spectacular effect. I could buy lots more effects in Premiere Pro that I use to edit, but I ain't going to do it. I'm keeping it simple.
JD's very talented, and I don't think he's ever had any professional training. It's something he does on the side.
Yeah.
So that's not his livelihood.
No, he's a carpenter, I believe.
Wow. He's getting too good.
I'm extremely
feeling the heat.
Yeah.
All right, so you did the first event at Field Day, which brought all your equipment out. You don't have a permanent station at this museum.
No,
that's correct.
We would like to. Of course, you know, they don't want us to hang any permanent antennas on the monument. That would be
we've obviously, everybody that's gone out there has looked at the big, tall tower of the memorial and said, gosh, it'd be nice to put a beam up there. but that's we've never even actually broached that idea with the museum.
Okay, so everything has been Field Day style.
Right.
So you did the first event, and what led to doing the second event?
Well, we had planned that all along. We had planned when we went into this, we had the vision of doing events for the full 4 years of the World War. But we knew that we better get through the first year first and then figure out where we were at. And so we had planned four events for 2014. The one starting in July, we had another one at the beginning of August, had another one at the beginning of September, and then our fourth event is the December 27th, 28th. So we had planned four events going into 2014, but didn't commit to 2015 until just recently.
So August was the declaration of war. Mm-hmm. September 6th was
the Battle
of the Marne, or the Miracle of the Marne. Mm-hmm. And, of course, coming up on December 27th, 28th, this upcoming event is the Christmas Truce.
Right.
You want to tell them about the events for next year that we got?
Yeah, sure. We've actually got, I don't know if those are up on the website yet or not, but we've got four events scheduled for 2015, starting in February 7th and 8th, which is ostensibly when the air war began in World War One. May 9th and 10th, which is the commemoration of the sinking of Lusitania. September 12th and 13th, which is kind of when the trench warfare began in earnest. And then the last event in 2015 will be December 12th and 13th, which is commemorating the withdrawal from Gallipoli. So we're avoiding field day in 2015.
Whenever anybody does a big thing like this, it takes somebody to have the great idea. And probably somebody who is capable of doing some arm twisting to get some help. Who had the big idea?
Clay Wilson. He's had the big idea. Like I said, he's been a volunteer for the museum for a number of years. His call sign is N0WWI. So he's obviously got an affiliation or an affinity for World War One already. He had the big idea, and then we knew we kind of formed a core team of some individuals here locally, and then realized that we needed the help and the support of amateur radio clubs from all over the area to make this happen.
Were the people that he first contacted already affiliated one way or another with the museum, or just friends of his in ham radio?
No, they weren't. In fact, they weren't even friends of his, because I did not. I'm one of them, and I did not know Clay prior to my my involvement in this.
So how did he hook up with you?
Well, that's a long story. The Kansas City is blessed with a gentleman named Larry Staples, W0AIB, who runs an email reflector, and he's been running that for 15, 20 years, a long time. And basically, that's how all the hams in Kansas City area and actually beyond get their news about what's going on in ham radio in Kansas City. And so Larry posted a thing on the list that said, "Hey, Clay Wilson has had this idea. If you're interested in getting involved in this, let me know or let Clay know." So I was one of about a half a dozen folks that responded to that. To that request, and we met at a Dunkin' Donuts in Overland Park in August or September of 2013, and that's what started it.
There's nobody left who was active military in World War One. Did you have family or some connection to it?
No. There is. Go ahead.
Well, I was going to say I had a grandfather who served.
It's funny how you, once you start getting people involved, you find those connections and you find the things that come up that people remember and the artifacts and things like that they remember from their grandfathers and whatnot. But all of the World War One veterans have deceased as of 3 or 4 years ago, I believe.
Did you find instant buy-in from the radio clubs that you started to make presentation to, or did it take a while to get them?
I've got kind of an interesting story.
Okay, go ahead.
At the Midway Division RL in London, which was November of last year.
Yeah, we had a little Skype hiccup, and I lost where this event was. So it was a convention someplace. What convention and where was it?
It was the ARRL Midwest Division Convention, which was held in Lebanon, Missouri in November of 2013. Herb approached me and said, "Would the Raytown Amateur Radio Club be interested in participating in these special events?" I said, "Sure, tell me about it." He says, "Well, it's going to be on field day, first one." And I think I told you flat out, "Oh, that ain't going to happen."
do you guys already do a big field day activity with the Raytown Club?
Raytown is huge on field day and is ranked in the top 10 in our class for a number of years. And my gut feeling was if I go back to the club and say, "This is what we want to do," they're going to laugh me out of the room. However, it was presented to us in such a manner that we could possibly do this as a combination special event field day. And there were a lot of people that said it couldn't be done. And that's how we got involved.
It was the challenge, huh? It couldn't be done yet.
Possibly it was the challenge, but Clay actually kind of went on the speaking circuit. He got on the agendas of many of the field days and some of the ham fests in the area and gave a presentation asking for support from the various amateur radio clubs. And we had already committed that Raytown was going to we had the first one locked in, but after that, people were literally arm wrestling each other to see who could take the remaining slots.
Yeah, we just announced our 2015 schedule just a couple weeks ago, and we've already got two of those slots filled.
Right, and we've already committed to September of next year.
Oh, darn. I was hoping we were going to do that one. Oh, well.
Okay, so,
we got three of those slots.
It has now become a competition among the local clubs.
Yes.
And
well, it's very prestigious, too.
Yeah, premier event.
And it's a lot of fun.
So, and it is divided up among the clubs. Each one doesn't have to do everything or is not right. part of and every one of them. So you get one a year,
We should emphasize, too, that if you want to come and help operate, you don't necessarily have to be a member of that club that's sponsored. Each individual club will manage and coordinate, who's going to be operating when, but they invite, everyone to participate.
So tell me about the operation. We saw a little bit of it on the video, at least the way your field day was set up. What do you set up or what have you? Because this one's going to be a little bit different, so we'll talk about that in a minute. But for the other two events this year, what kinds of stuff did you set up? Is it each club does their own, so I guess everybody rolls their own.
Right.
To a point, yeah. Because of the sponsorship we've gotten from ICOM and US Tower and people like that, the museum basically provides most of the equipment. We provide or arrange for the towers, the antennas, and the radios, provide a tent to set up in. Provide the space, obviously, to do that. The clubs obviously bring the people in terms of they manage the human resources to set up, operate, and tear down, and then also coordinate the activities. And if they want to add anything in terms of antennas or radios or anything to the operation, they can do that also. So it relieves some of the burden on the clubs so that they don't have to furnish all the equipment. They don't have to cart all the stuff in. We store a lot of that at the museum. And so it makes that operation a little easier. But the setup is pretty much what you would expect from a field day setup, even on the weekends that weren't field day.
And from our perspective, it was kind of unique in that we wanted to have the elements needed for field day as well. So we had a phone HF station, a CW HF station, a VHF station, a GATA station, all those incorporated into it. But the following events was typically at least one HF station for phone, one for CW. We try to have a VHF station that can work 6 meters and 10 meters if that band opens. They also, each club pretty much provides its own repeater for VHF communications. On one hand, we need control and coordination.
Mm-hmm.
But we also have... where members of the public are coming in and they're interested in, like, would you like to try ham radio? We arrange for someone to be at the other end of the repeater to actually converse with these people, which is definitely helpful. Ham radio is best foot forward.
And you were telling me about where things were located. I think it was...
yeah, if you move your arrow just to the south side of that sidewalk there. There you go.
Right in
that area.
Yep.
Okay. So you have a great big open field.
Yes. It's a combination of the memorial grounds in Penn Valley Park. Is that what they call it?
I think that's right.
Yeah.
All right, so that's a pretty good spot, although not a lot of antenna supports that I see here.
No, we've been blessed again with the towers that we've had. We haven't had to put up too many wire antennas.
Right. We did put up, I think, a wire antenna for the Santa Fe Club between two of our portable towers, mm-hmm. and that worked very well.
Yeah.
It's kind of a high promontory. You can't tell from that aerial picture, but it is a high promontory. It sits up on a bluff. So it has some elevation above the average terrain.
And what kind of traffic does it get from the public? The museum is probably fairly popular, so people
on Field Day weekend, which was our first operation, which was the commemoration of the beginning of World War One. The museum had a number of things going on that same weekend, and so there were thousands of visitors there, and we had a steady stream of folks in amongst all the Field Day. Chaos that was going on. We had a steady stream of public coming on, and we've had that. We get quite a bit of public traffic, so it's great outreach for ham radio in addition to the museum.
What's interesting, too, is the park is a very beautiful place, mm-hmm. so a lot of wedding parties come, at least for their photographs. So we had a lot of people in formal attire walking through our radio site.
September weekend, we counted 13 wedding parties on Saturday night that came to have their pictures taken. Some of them came in and talked to us. We had
we did too.
Primarily because we had the only porta potty around, so that was.
Yeah, it's important to have some of those facilities that catch the attention of the public. So how did that work out? Did, did people stop by for a couple of minutes? Did you get a few people? I know you got...
Well, we put them on the air.
Got,
I say it varies. It varies depending on their interests and depending on what they, you know, the questions they ask and whatnot. But it varies from just, you know, a few minutes of just explaining what we're doing and what ham radio is. And there have been people that have stayed there for half hour, 45 minutes.
Sure.
The field day event weekend, we had a member of the news media come on Saturday morning, or it was Sunday morning. Either way.
No.
Yeah. And we put her on the air. She made several contacts.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's always awesome.
And they put that on TV that night.
Yeah.
And I'm sure you got this guy, and maybe many of this guy. I was a ham back 25 years ago, and I've been either inactive or let my license lapse. I didn't even know you were still around. Mm-hmm. You got that guy.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you got him back on the
air.
We
were prepared for that. I mean, we you know, that's one of the things that we talk to the clubs about when we organize these events is that, you know, hey, this is, in addition to being a fun opportunity to get on the air and operate a special event station, recognize that we're in a public location that gets a lot of traffic. You're going to get public in and out of there, and let's make sure that we put our best foot forward. Let's not wear the tinfoil hats. Let's try to keep our decorum at a level that is appropriate
for
the public.
Look good.
Yeah, and be prepared, you know, with flyers and have somebody kind of on duty looking for those folks that are going to come in and ask questions.
The most common question I got was, you must be demonstrating how they communicated in World War One.
Yeah.
And of course, no, this actually, radio was just in its very infancy during the war. So
yeah.
we're not that old.
Yeah, it was. And do they have anything of the radio equipment inside the museum?
They do. As a matter of fact, they've got an old spark gap transmitter. There is some evidence and some artifacts of using wireless in the form of spark gap. That would be the transmitter would be up in a dirigible, and they would send reconnaissance information back to a receiver on the ground. And the museum has an example of one of those transmitters.
Yeah, that would be an amazing opportunity for full-time ham radio, but full-time ham radio presence in something like that would be just an amazing drain of resources. They're very hard to do. Most places that have tried a full-time museum have had a hard time doing that.
Yeah.
So you're dealing with the public. I did a show a couple shows ago with some guys at the North Carolina Mountain State Fair that put up a big operation at the state fair demonstrating ham radio to the public. And I asked those guys how they explain what ham radio is. So let me ask you the same question. I am a member of the public, has maybe heard of ham radio, but that's about it. I may have heard the name. What is ham radio? Explain it to me.
I would have to say that the elevator speech I give is it's an awful lot of fun. It's public service. It's science and industry. There's so many different things that you can do in ham radio that you can pretty much pick and choose what interests you most and run with it. Some people will look at me a little bit cross-eyed at first, but then when I explain to them that you don't have to spend a fortune to get into it, yes, there is a test, but a lot of that entry-level test is common sense. You learn a little bit of technical information, and we have all these other guys and gals around who would love to help you out. It's a community, it's just a heck of a lot of fun. Our actual membership with the Raytown Amateur Radio Club spiked as far as new members through this event.
Oh, did it really?
Oh, yeah. Okay. We got about 15 new members.
Wow.
Just during the period we were doing this because they wanted to be involved.
People who were already hams or people that interested in ham radio from...
We had unlicensed people come to us and actually ask us, how can I get licensed? How can I do this with you? And, of course, once we had one young lady, she's actually one of the volunteers at the museum,
mm-hmm.
and we sat her down at an HF station with an experienced operator and had her make some contacts. Boy, she was hooked.
Did this operation put a big crimp in your GOTA score? Not your GOTA score, your field day score.
It honestly, we didn't score as well as we have in the past.
Because you were busy explaining everything.
No, not so much because we were busy explaining, but it was because the whole strategy was different. We weren't out to to win points at all costs. We were definitely trying to put ham radio's best foot forward and to have fun doing it. And this is a paradigm shift for what we've done in the past as a club. But everyone agreed that this was the path we wanted to go. We didn't want to become known as the field day zealots. We wanted to be known as a field day activity where we're having fun and getting things done. And it worked very well.
Yeah, and you guys were forced off the air for about 3 or 4 hours due to the weather.
Thunderstorm, yeah. One of our tents got picked up tossed across the parking
lot. Wow.
It happens.
All right. That's so, field day. So Herb, as Randy was explaining ham radio, were you just nodding in total agreement, or do you have a different way of explaining it?
No, I think that's a good way of explaining it. It is such a vast and broad hobby that it's difficult to make an elevator speech. I think you can. The beauty of having an operation like WW1 USA there is that you can point to things and say this is part of the hobby. But the stuff that Randy's talking about how easy it is to get into the hobby. And the camaraderie and the social community that comes along with ham radio is all spot on. But it's you almost have to have it's much easier to explain ham radio to a non-ham when you have something like that going on behind you that you can point to and say, here's an example.
You've had the three operations going on so far, and now we've got one more coming up the end of this month, the last weekend in December. And you're going to do something a little bit different this time. How is that going to be put together?
Well, this is Kansas City, and it gets cold here in the wintertime. We have been blessed with pretty good weather for our June, August, and September events.
Plus or minus a tent.
Obviously, we can't.
Yeah, plus or minus a tent being tossed across the parking lot.
Yeah, well, yeah. I mean, you expect that. I mean, this is Kansas City. You get some storms, too. But obviously, we're not going to be able to set up in the same spot again in December because it may be 10 degrees and snowing.
You could be shoveling snow.
You could be shoveling snow. So, you know, we felt that it was important to work this particular, commemorate this particular event in World War One. So we're going to be working from inside the museum and we're going to do it as a totally remote operation in that we will be controlling rigs scattered around Kansas City through the internet using a couple of different remote technologies.
What will those remote technologies be? Because the audience will be interested in how you're going to do this.
Because ICOM is one of our major sponsors. We will be using ICOM donated 2 HF rigs to us. Both are capable of being operated remotely using their RSVA1 remote software. And we'll have that set up actually for 3 rigs. The 2 that they have donated to us for the use for this event and 1 that belongs to one of the members of the club, the World War One club. And then we have a second technology. It's a technology called Remote Rig. It's a company called Microbit out of Sweden. And it works a little differently in that it's kind of a black box hardware solution rather than a software solution. So we'll actually have the faceplate of an ICOM radio down there at the museum, but it will be communicating to its radio, the rest of the box, that'll be in the home of the person that owns it. So, and will be connected through all of that, will be connected through the internet.
Have you thought much about how you're going to explain that part of the operation to the public? Are you going to even bother to say it's remote or?
Santa's elves.
We've had some conversations about that. There is some, there's some trepidation that if we do it this way, that how is that any different than Skype? And so there's been some, that's one of the reasons why we'd like to have the remote rig thing there. So we at least have a faceplate that looks like a radio, rather than just looking at a computer screen. But it will require a little bit more explanation. But we're more interested in whether or not it'll work than we are on how to explain it at this point. We're still working out some bugs.
Yeah, I imagine you're going to be trying some practice runs, many practice runs, probably already done a few.
Yeah.
And shake all this stuff out.
Yeah, we will do that, and we'll have it all relatively well shook out before the 27th and 28th.
When you had things set up at the museum grounds, was that an RF-friendly environment, or were you getting bombarded by noise and junk?
It was surprisingly good.
The only RF interference we got, and it wasn't significant, was there was a maker fair going on at Union Station, which was probably about maybe 700 yards away.
Yeah, I'd say about half a mile.
And they had a Jacob's ladder.
They had a spark gap transmitter.
If you listen hard, you could hear it. You could hear it.
Yeah, we were worried about that going in, that, you know, being in the middle of the, you know, kind of the downtown area there with high rises around, and there's a couple of 1,000-foot TV towers within a half a mile of the site, that we'd have a problem. But really, it's been, from an operation standpoint, it's been a very successful site.
A very good location.
Yeah, but the remote systems you'll have, the stations that you picked are probably some pretty decent stations that you can remote into.
One of them's actually rural.
Yeah, one of them's rural. The other one of them is mine, which is not particularly rural, but it is what it is. But yeah, I think that the interesting conversation you have in this remote operation is that you kind of have to throw away a lot of the paradigms you have with field day operations, because you worry about interference. And the reality here is we could have, we're going to have four stations in play. We could have all four of them running phone on 20 meters, and they wouldn't interfere with each other. So it kind of opens you up to some new operations that you hadn't thought about
before. And so where are you going to be operating?
We will be inside the lobby of the museum.
I'm sorry. Let's do that, because I'm wondering if they're giving you a good spot. Right inside the lobby, everyone's going to walk past you.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. It will be, it's not quite in the middle of things, but it's just off to the side, basically the main traffic path.
All right.
We're right across from the bathroom, as it turns out. So we'll get lots of visitors.
Even better. All right. So what I was really thinking of is, what frequencies, what bands are people going to find you on?
Okay.
TMI.
That's a good, yeah, too much information. We typically start out at about 14.260 on phone. A lot of it depends on what's going on that weekend and where the bands will allow, some of propagation allows. I don't know where the CW guys start out.
It's
usually 40 meters.
Typically what will happen is, once they decide on where they're going to be, somebody will spot. And as soon as that happens, the floodgates open. I was operating with the Santa Fe group, and I thought, oh, this is going to be really dead. I was operating in the evening on 20 meters, and someone spotted us and shouted across the tent, "Hey, I just spotted you guys." And immediately I had a pile up to deal with it. For me, it was great, because that's the first time I'd ever been on that end of the pileup, which was real exciting.
It's fun, isn't it?
Yeah.
I was going to ask about that. There's lots of special event operations throughout the year from different ham operations, and some seem to attract pileups and lots of activity, and some just, kind of whistling in the wind. Sounds like you're one of those that gets a lot of attention and pileups and stay very busy.
Yeah, it comes and goes, but I mean, for the three events so far, we've made over 4,000 contacts. So, for the hours that we've operated, we've stayed pretty busy. That's a pretty good run rate. And I don't know what to attribute it to. I don't know why this special event is popular and some others aren't. But I think everybody that's operated has had a period of some good pileups and some really steady traffic at one time or another. The overnights are a little dead, but
it depends on propagation.
Yeah, it depends on propagation. And we've worked a fair amount of DX. We've worked 88 different countries throughout all this. So it's not just the states.
So you're almost up to DXCC.
Yeah, we're getting close.
In fact, I think we might be. It's just a matter of how are we going to report the...
Not DXCC. Worked all states. We worked all 50 states. We just haven't got them all confirmed yet.
All right. I'm looking at the website. I see that there is a certificate, although I don't see a picture of the certificate anyplace. But
actually, the museum helps us with that. Their marketing department, their graphics folks put those together. And it's a different one for each event.
Okay. You do have a good certificate.
Yeah. And we will do QSL cards. In fact, I'm the QSL manager. And so when we get QSL cards with a self-addressed stamped envelope, we will return a WW1 USA QSL card. And we've also just started doing EQSL and logbook for world.
All right. So this operation coming up, looking at the website, is the Warrensburg Area Amateur Radio Club. They are the sponsoring club.
That's correct.
Right.
Okay.
And they're doing that in conjunction with Joplin. Right.
Okay. Joplin's kind of a ways out of town, right? It's like the middle of the state.
So is Warrensburg. Yeah. Warrensburg's about an hour away.
So
Warrensburg is considered central Missouri, and Joplin's considered southwest.
Southwest, yeah.
All right. So you guys are just you're the thing.
Yeah, apparently we are.
And this one is coming up. It's the last weekend, last Saturday and Sunday of December, the 27th and 28th, and it starts at got it down here someplace.
10 a.m. on Saturday. Let's see, 1600 hours.
This UTC? Yeah, the email I got said 1500 hours UTC.
Well, that was probably before it went off daylight savings time. So,
okay, yeah. So 10 a.m. Central be 11 a.m. Eastern or 1600 UTC, which is important because there's going to be people all over the world that are going to be looking for you. Right. And now that you've been on here on Ham Radio Now, you're not going to be able to handle the traffic. So I probably ought to line up a few more stations.
We'll keep those four stations busy. We'll just hope the internet connection holds up.
Yeah.
It should be awesome. Maybe I'll fire up a radio and give you a call. Do you do any digital modes, PSK or
Caltech? We have works in PSK. We'll probably work more of it this time. Remote. What we're finding out is that remote operation doesn't lend itself real well to CW. And so we'll probably be doing more PSK and maybe some RTTY this time.
All right. And the call sign of the event is WW1 USA. World War One USA. And that's not a vanity. Well, it's not a special event call. It's a vanity.
That's a club call sign.
Yeah. So you guys got a club call and then made a vanity out of it. Did you say it was a specific club that is the sponsor of the event and then it, you know, farms out the operation to area clubs?
Right. The core planning group formed the World War One Museum Amateur Radio Club shortly after we started organizing. And that's who owns the club call sign, and that's kind of the home club for all the operations. And then we farm out the manpower and the other parts of the operation to the local clubs.
All right. And if anybody happens to be in the Kansas City area that weekend, certainly welcome to come by and operate.
You bet.
And the museum sounds like it is a must see venue, not for ham radio, just because of what it is.
Yeah, and in fact, if you're a ham, for the weekends that we are operating, so the December 27th and 28th would apply, you can get discounted admission. Normal admission to the museum is $14 a person. For those weekends when you're operating, if you show your license, you can get in for $5, you and three guests.
Right, so a family of four can get in it for $5 per head.
Yeah.
Ah, cool. So go to Kansas City. I'm going to Kansas City. I want to ask you one question being in Kansas City. We talked about this before the show a little bit. Nothing to do with ham radio. You got the Google Fiber there. Tell me about that.
Well, it looks like we may be going to it. I don't have it yet, so I can't really experience it.
They haven't come to my neighborhood, so I don't have an opinion.
Okay, well, but the hams around that you've talked to, they must be talking about it. It must have been a big topic of conversation.
It's starting to get...
Yeah, I say they really haven't connected hardly anybody yet. They're digging a lot of holes and
we see their trucks all over town and their technicians,
but they haven't really connected very many people yet.
You can recognize their vans have that rainbow colored rabbit on the side.
Okay, because I've got gigabit Ethernet from here to the other side of the shack, and that's cool to be able to send stuff 15 feet. I can't imagine gigabit over the internet.
Yeah,
their package, I think, is including, you know, all your video needs. So
yeah, if you want to buy that,
they're competing with cable.
Yep, but so you guys are looking forward to it. Sounds like you haven't had the opportunity or know people that have had the opportunity to actually play with it yet.
Not yet,
right?
But it's an economic engine. It's driving interest in startups and companies to move to your area.
Yeah, I think the Kansas City, Kansas area was actually the first community that got Google Fiber, and I think they competed fairly hard for that, and it is driving quite a bit of economic development, I think, business development in Kansas City, Kansas so far.
Okay, that's right across the river, right?
Yes, yeah, it's part of the metro area, just on the other side. It's on the Kansas side of the river versus the Missouri side.
We also have State Line Road right up the middle, so you can walk from one state to another.
Okay, so that's Kansas City. Kansas is the small town. Kansas City, yes, Missouri,
smaller
is the big city.
It's still a pretty good sized town.
I'm going to get email on that. But Kansas City, Missouri is the big city.
Right. And Overland Park, Kansas, now I think is actually bigger than Kansas City, Missouri.
Or Kansas City, Missouri. Really?
Yeah, they're pretty close in size now.
Yeah. So. We've got a number of large suburbs that rival the size of the two Kansas cities.
Wow. The suburbs
but if you tell someone you're from Overland Park, they go, where's that?
Oh, yeah. It's so you got to be Kansas City. And then you don't have to be specific about what state or, you know, just Kansas City. I do remember being out there a long time ago. I was doing a video shoot for a company I was working for, and somebody, we were out in a railroad yard, and it's a big railroad hub, isn't it?
Yeah.
Or at least it has been. And somebody took us to some famous steakhouse. I don't remember what it was, but boy, was it good. So.
Yeah, there's a lot of those in town, actually.
Yeah, the Golden Ox. Either the Golden Ox, which is down in the bottom.
Which is closing.
Yeah, or the Hereford House.
Yeah,
that's the
both. Hereford House.
Yeah.
All right. Well, that sounds great. Anything else about this operation that we somehow have managed not to cover?
No, look for us in 2015, and there'll be more information on the WW1USA.org website.
Yeah, okay, and that is the place to go, WW1USA.org. And find out what's going on. Will you announce specific frequencies? Is there anything sort of like real time going on there when you're in operation?
We do some of that. We also, I typically post something on the EHAM and QRZ special event forums a couple weeks prior to give a notice, and we provide some frequencies in there.
Watch
the X-Spots.
All right. Well, thanks for coming on the show, and let's gin up some more serious activity for you guys.
Yeah, there you go. Thanks for having us, Gary.
Bye-bye. Thanks, Randy. Thank you, Herb. Awesome-sounding operation. WW1USA, it's going to be easy to hear on the air not this weekend, but I don't know when you're going to be watching this program. Sometime. Last weekend in December, and then several more dates throughout the next year, and several more years if they're able to keep things going. And it sounds like they've got a good start, so. Probably they will. So let's see what else. I'm going to get back to editing some Tapper stuff. I made promises about other programs that I want to get done. I know there's a lot of stuff in the on the hard drives waiting to get edited, but it's Tapper time. So I've got to get some of that stuff done. So that's what's coming up next. If you've enjoyed the Ham Radio Now programs and have a little bit left over at the end of your Christmas list, hamradionow.tv. Go see my buddy Arvin. And help us out. If not, well, we'll see you next year. No problem. 73, I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, over and out.